World War One, Day Two, Battles, Events, America Enters the War, Woodrow Wilson, 14 points, all of that. Let's start with some Sabaton, because why not?
Hey, Garrett. Savannah. Oh, that's a cute shirt, Savannah.
To, I know it's not on anyone's favorite hits list or anything like that here in America. It's a Swedish rock band, and they do historically accurate music, a lot of times focused on World War I or even earlier. So, music video and such like that was following the Great War. I think the song was called The Great War. They sing some English lyrics. They also sing some of their language, you know, Swedish, Norse-type lyrics. So, just an interesting band. Some of their videos are really on point. They have an awesome song about the Christmas truce of 1914. So I just figured we'd start class with that today. Let's briefly, now I've still got a couple of you that need to take a test, so I'm not saying test questions, but let's briefly look at our numbers overall. Who wants to see them? Who doesn't want to see them? What do we got?
I didn't get my list.
There. We got 100. We had 100 in the room, so don't tell me it was impossible to ace the thing. We had 100 in the room. Four of you in the 90s, and that ranged from high 90s to, I think it was 91, but in the 90s. Definitely the bulk of our numbers in the 80s, okay? 12 of you in the 80s.
Who made the 100?
A couple of you trickled into the 70s. Okay, and then we have some hanging out at the bottom. I'm not saying names, but I'm being honest with you. Had some comments, had a couple of hanging out at the bottom in the 60s, 50s, and 40s. So what I give to you is this. Last time, hey, you guys were really energized about your test scores, I can tell. Last time I listed out every single number. You can see that we had 598, 293, whatever the case was. This time I did it brackets like this. What I want you to understand is this. A lot of times y'all hanging out at the bottom, make excuses for yourself. And you say, oh, that test was so hard. Those questions were impossible to understand. Nobody got an A on that test. Are any of those statements true? Yeah, that test was doable. Now you got to be honest with you. You got to look in the mirror. You got to decide, was your studying process good enough? What could you have possibly done differently? Given that you have some classmates hanging out at the top of the bracket, do you need to consult with them for some study tips and study materials? You got to be honest with you. So this is how we did. I will applaud excellence where I see it. And what are we talking about today?
World War I.
Yes, World War One, day two of World War One, U.S. entry into World War One. So I'm about to hand you notes for today. And at first I felt like I made a mistake because I did not print them front back. But in the end, I do realize that these notes,
If they were front back, you're going to have to be kind of flipping them back and forth a little bit based off of how they're laid out. But now, given that it's not front back, you could just put these two pages in front of you. And as I walk through the conversation today, you'll have both pages in front of you. This is more on the vocab side. It's not wait for fill in the blank as much as yesterday. A little bit more. This is a little bit more like the open vocabulary, where you're gonna just see each term and write what you need to about it.
Woo!
I hear it.
All right.
Why is this funny? Because, like, World War I, isn't like there's a guy pointing at everybody. Like, 20 years since your weapons were so big. And then three guys were so small. What? That is hilarious.
That's it. That's not even making sense.
So, first of all, what cartoon did this come from? Family Guy, right? So, it's a bit of a meme. And what we got here is 20th century weapons. What were some of those new technologies we talked about yesterday?
Tanks.
Thanks.
Oh, machine guns.
Machine guns.
Hand grenades.
Planes.
Submarines. Yes.
Submarines. Excellent. And then?
Yes.
Gas masks.
Right. All right. So 20th century weapons and technology, but 19th century tactics. What were those?
Trenches.
Assaulting over open ground. We don't exactly hide behind cover all the time. We'll talk about trench warfare in just a second. Baseball players, you're killing me.
I need a piece of paper.
So what you, and then the joke here is, now Noah's Ark and Family Guy and sacrilegious and all that kind of stuff, but what we got a character here that's an elephant penguin, which is World War I. And he says, what the heck is this? So
he didn't say what.
Yeah, he said, what the heck is this?
He said that.
That's right.
Thank you.
So anyway, it is to make the point that it's a merger of tactics. Today, we're going to get into battles and events of World War I, kind of day two of our conversation. Two really heavy days, two really dense days in terms of conversation and the amount of stuff you've been taking notes on. So I know that. I know that the lecture has been heavy for a couple of days, but we're going to continue onward. Remind me of the analogy I used for the steps that started World War I. Okay, there's the main causes, M-A-I-N-N, but I use an analogy for what got all the countries involved.
Brother, sister, brother.
Kind of like a bar fight, right? There's the two little brothers that started picking on each other, scrap. But because of the alliances, go ahead, please. Because of the alliances, who all got involved?
Everybody.
And then I did use a second analogy right towards the end of class, which was dominoes falling. Boom, 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 boom. So as a reminder, first thing that happened is that Archduke Franz Ferdinand is assassinated. That gets Austria-Hungary and Serbia picking at each other. Well, Austria declares war on Serbia. Germany expresses its support for Austria. Not straight up declaring war, but just that international proclamation of we support Serbia, which is about the same thing. Russia supports the other side, we support Serbia. So, what started off as two little kids on the block scrapping with each other, now gets the big players on either side. Germany and Russia are the big players. Germany, not to be outdone, just jump straight for that declaration of war against Russia. Germany, you know, while we're at it, I'm going to declare war on France. And from left field, Great Britain declares war on Germany. So now we got a lot of big players involved in the war. Boom, 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 boom. The dominoes are falling. Right? I'm so sorry. I can't So that now gets us to, right, this all happened so fast. What started off as a parade on a nice sunny afternoon leads to an assassination, leads to 6 days later, Europe is at war with itself. And what we're going to have is a two-front landing. Last time, someone's going to move. So the two of you are going to decide who's going to move. It's going to be fun to watch.
Me.
Me.
Two-front war. When I say front, what is a front?
The front.
Side. The front.
A side. I like a side. So how do I have a two-front war?
Oh, two-front war is that
two
basically
sides.
You're fighting over here, you're also fighting over there.
That's exactly right. A two-front war has two distinctly different areas of fighting. Make a modern example for you. When the United States was in Iraq and Afghanistan, we're kind of fighting two fronts at the same time. One army, two locations, difficult to sustain the manpower, the supplies, the ammunition, the food, the fuel. What we have here is a two-front war, and the country that's going to split itself is Germany. The first front is going to be, I got to have my stick today, known as the Western Front, and that is on the German-French border. So the Western Front, as it's on the western part of the map, is between Germany and France, and a lot of these big battles happen right here on the Western Front. This is where the trench lines happen. I'm going to remind us about the trenches here in just a second. The other side of the war is known as the Eastern Front, and it happens between Germany and Russia. A little bit less trench warfare, a little bit more movement along the Eastern Front, whereas the Western Front was that stalemate between each other. So Western Front, Eastern Front, Germany is stressed out in the middle. Germany has to split its national resources, its army, its manpower, its food, its fuel, fighting on both sides. So you can imagine that eventually that's going to take a big toll on Germany, and the question will be, can they sustain it? We'll find out. So first of all, welcome to the trenches. This is a bit of a refresher, especially for my world historians, which most of you were. What are some characteristics of the trenches?
Talk about that.
Dirty.
Unclean, dirty.
Trench foot, not wet.
Wet. Yeah, big wet. Remember the tactics? Tell me a little bit more about the tactics.
What you mean?
They put fake people above the trenches.
Ooh, okay, that's true. They would sometimes put a fake head above the trench line if it got shot at. A lot of times, what's that? Gas the trenches, try to run them out of the trenches. How successful was trench warfare?
Really well.
Over the whole course of the war, 3,000 miles of trenches, 3 years of fighting, some of these trenches moved just meters in either direction. So it was not a super successful style of fighting. Did not really make it.
You're saying you're like the baseball players?
Oh, there they go. They were just waiting for the magical announcement. Fellas, where's my class going to be? Google Classroom.
Not here.
Hey, who we meet?
East Lawrence.
Everybody, East. Oh, that's where my class is going to be.
Yeah, we'll be East Lawrence.
Double header.
Good luck.
All right, get it going.
Good luck.
Hey, Kale.
Y'all got this.
You ball out today.
Think about winning. That's the mindset you need to have. Winning.
We got a kill.
Winning
mindset. We got a
kill.
We believe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know
what wins
wins?
Yeah.
Y'all got it. Hey, if you have a winning mindset, what does win stand for?
What does win stand for?
W-I-N, what's win stand for?
Win.
What's important now?
Huh?
Winners focus on what's right in front of them. Right, that last pitch that the umpire messed up. You're gonna get mad about it.
Wait, what'd you say it stands for?
Oh, fact.
What's that? That ball that you hit the net that barely.
Oh, tennis ladies, can you do anything about the last set?
No, you sure can.
What's important now?
No, it's always we win the first set and then we lose.
And then you're like,
here we have the trenches. I think I just said it, but about how many miles of trenches were there?
3,000.
3,000 miles of trench line. Now, trenches weren't straight. They were jagged. there were multi-layers of them. But, dude, to dig, hand dig that many miles of trench line into the earth, that's wow, impressive. That's a lot of labor. And it actually scarred the earth. I like to think of it as scarring the earth. When you dig into the earth, it's not like you just fill it back in. There are still trenches in Europe to this day because of the digging that happened over 100 years ago. So I'm going to blast through a handful of pictures here. You guys should, I hope you recognize some of these from the from last year. This is probably a very undeveloped example of a trench line. These guys kind of just scratched a hole into the ground, and it's enough to protect their body, but this is not the full undeveloped trench line. We're going to go over all of that. Here's an example of how they had to do it by hand. You can really even just tell how muddy and wet it is already. One shovel full at a time. One shovel full at a time is how these trenches were dug.
How long did it take?
The longer you were there, the more you could build it up. How long did it take? Well, Harrison, they kind of improved their trenches across the whole war. So initially, just scratching a little hole in the ground enough to put your body in to try to keep the bullets going over your head. But as the war went on, you can tell they started to dig in and really make a home out of it. There's wood involved. There's hammers involved. This is a little bit even more of a cutout to try to keep them dry. Point is, it continued to develop a whole lot more thoroughly. Really good graphic that shows what a fighting position might look like. The idea was that the trench line was higher than your head, right? So that the bombs and the bullets would go over your head. Now, if it was a direct hit of an artillery shell, boom, obviously that's going to hit you. But for the most part, if the artillery landed here, the shrapnel would go over your head. The bullets, of course, would go over your head. So soldiers had to have a bit of a step up in order to put their rifle over the top. Now, when they were actually going to go across the trenches, if they're going to go into, they're going to try to assault the enemy trenches. You remember what that was called? So they're going to go into no man's land. I just spoiled it. They're going to go into no man's land. Or was it called going over the top? Some of you got PTSD of me blowing that trench whistle. I can get it out. Hey, do you want me to get it out?
Yeah.
Good. They blow the whistle. That was their signaling because they couldn't always rely on the radios. And they would go over the top. Here's a really good picture of a developed trench system. There are the front lines. And guys would take turns on the front lines. You wouldn't just hang out on the front lines for 4 years straight. That would, like, tax your brain. Nobody could handle being on the front lines for 4 years straight. You'd usually be in, like, a three-part cycle. Front lines, support, reserve. About 1 week at a time. A week on the front, a week in support. That means you might be running ammunition and food and medical supplies back and forth, but you are off the front lines. It's a little less stressful. And then these reserve guys, they might have been hundreds of meters to the rear, could be called forward if they needed to be, but they were in reserve. Did I see a hand? No. Thought, question? Lady Earhart?
Nope. No.
Okay. You can tell even, now this is just a cartoon, but it's realistic. Sometimes they cut even farther into the earth in order to have a kind of a command headquarters where the generals could lay out their maps, have their radios, more protected from the bombing because they had to think straight, right? They had to sketch on their map. They had to come up with a battle plan. So very, very developed trench system, artillery way to the rear, okay, upwards of 5-6 miles to the rear, firing onto the enemy. And these guys, not dropping bombs, but what were they focused on doing? Yeah, eyeballs, scouting, trying to tell what the enemy was up to. Are they massing their troops over here? Do we see a billow of smoke? Maybe that indicates gas. That's what the airplanes were used for. So here's a real overhead image of trench line systems. And you can see kind of how jagged they were. You can see that the Germans, this is the old German flag, the Germans had a more developed trench system. The British, they were in the low ground for most of the fighting. Now, across different areas, might be slightly different across the thousands of miles. But for the most part, the British were in the low ground. What flows to the low ground?
Water.
Yeah, so the British usually had the worst situation when it came to digging their trenches and the flooding of the trenches. But just goes to show, it wasn't just a single scratch in the earth where it was two lines facing at each other.
Please release the 4th grade students.
Super well-developed trench line systems. Probably. Anybody?
Forrester?
Ivan. She is wearing a forest on her shirt. A couple of pictures of life in the trenches. Just goes to show you how ugly the war really got, how brutal it was to exist in the trenches. Has anyone had their feet wet for more than an hour at a time?
Yes, and it was.
Okay, 2 hours.
It hurt.
Okay, 3 hours.
I slept outside.
Really? I heard it hurts. I heard it's nasty. I heard, like, if you're in a bathtub, you get those pretty fingers. We, at most, like, be honest with you, whether you're in the swimming pool or whether you got caught in the rain or whether you camped overnight, like, at most, your feet have been wet for a couple hours tops. These guys existed in the water for days or even weeks.
That's nasty.
And we talked about the ramifications of that. I'm going to show you those nasty pictures here in a second. Yeah, oh, there is fungus among us for sure. This guy, he's smiling. I don't know why, but he's smiling. This is a really good example of how this is probably in the reserve or support portion. What is that an international symbol for?
Medical,
yeah. So they had trench hospitals. Not the most sanitary of conditions, right? You watch Grey's Anatomy, and they're all obsessed with washing their hands and being sterile and stuff like that. I'm not going to watch Grey's. These guys, probably not super concerned with the, like, sterileness of what they had going on, because they're literally living in the dirt. Did the best they could, but they're living in the dirt. Now, life in the dirt leads to, you guys have said it, what's this known as?
Trench foot.
Trench foot was such a dangerous condition that they actually had these posters warning against it. I'll give you my personal example. To this day, the year 2022, a soldier's foot is tied to his morale. If soldiers have a blister, if they have wet feet, if they have cracks in their feet, their morale, their attitude is going to go down from there. Come on in. Welcome to school. I'm glad you're here. So trench foot. Trench foot was a big deal, and I think I have some pictures. Yeah, oh, there's a medic checking on the feet. So amidst the bombs and the bullets, everybody is concerned about feet, because if your feet go downhill, everything goes downhill.
Tuck in and relax.
And then these guys right here, super tough guys. They've been on the front lines. Make no mistake about it. They're no sissies, but they literally can't even put pressure on their foot to walk. It's so tender or it's so cut up that they had to get a ride out of the trenches into the field hospital. Because their feet, imagine this picture, now it's all wrapped up. Their feet probably looked like graphic alert, probably looked like that. That's trench foot, my friends. There's some frostbite there as well. The black skin might have been frozen. But this is trench foot.
No, it's not.
The product did not take it. I gave you the graphic warning. I told you it was coming. All right, anyway, life in the trenches. I know we talked about it a lot last semester. Austin actually stood in the tub of water. He did the trench foot simulation. Anybody else? I can't remember exactly. Who did it?
Katie Dominguez.
That's right. Katie Dominguez outside. You good? Like kablooing? Okay. Yeah, so you guys remember the trenches a little bit. I'm glad. It's one of my favorite classes to talk about. Machine guns, trench line. You can see the Germans have the high ground. How do I know they're Germans?
Their hats.
That's right, their helmet. German. They have the high ground shooting to the low ground. That's always an advantage in the military. Another picture here. These guys flat out, they had so much time to build their trenches. They put in a boardwalk. They put in a sidewalk, if you will. So just goes to show maybe they should have been more focused on fighting instead of being comfortable in the trenches. Maybe the war would have been over sooner. This is an example of going over the top, right? So I can almost hear the whistle. I can hear the bomb. I can smell the smoke. I can put myself there. This is an example of them going over the top. And on the other side, this is an example of what might have been waiting for them. Many people who went over the top did not come back to talk about it. Go over the top with machine guns ready to cut you down. Going over the top just wasn't the best strategy. I don't know why they kept doing it over and over and over. Sleep. Soldiers got to sleep. And in the trenches, in the trench, those are sandbags. Yep. Soldiers, Chandler, let me tell you this. Soldiers can sleep anywhere. It's a skill. It's something that it's just innate. They don't teach it to you. It's just something you know. Realistically, I'll tell you, sleep is a weapon. Okay. Sometimes you see a picture of a soldier like that, and the first thought might be he's lazy. I'm telling you, soldiers don't get to sleep on a traditional 8-hour at nighttime rotation. So sometimes you just got to sleep where you can. And this is, you can find many pictures of guys sleeping in the trenches. This is one good example of him sleeping wherever he could. Not being lazy, but like literally recharging his body because he'd probably been awake for 24 plus hours. Trenches and foxholes. You think there's still a place for them in the military today?
Yes.
There is. This is a modern example of a fox or a fighting hole. Now, not miles and miles of trenches. Okay, we don't typically fight like that. But more as a protective measure, these guys scratched out a hole into the earth to go to sleep so that they'd be protected from artillery. Similar to what I said earlier, I mean, if the bomb comes in and it lands right there, it is what it is, right? But if the bomb lands right here, here's how bombs work. They explode up and out. So if the shrapnel goes up and out and he's below the earth, he's going to protect him. He's going to protect him. So that's why guys dig fighting holes today. This picture right here, I can feel this picture too. Like, I feel like I've been there. They didn't dig down as much as they just did build up. But I feel the mud. I feel the wet. I have a poncho just like that.
Mr. Swanson?
Yes.
I need Madison Easterly for checkout, please.
On the way. On the way.
Thank you.
And again, just one more example. These are Marines in Iraq, I think 2003.
He's barefoot.
He's barefoot. Yep, he's protecting his feet. You got to take your socks off.
If you keep those socks on,
that's right. That's right. Part of it, even when it's cold, and that's the hardest thing to do. Trust me, that's the hardest thing to do when it's cold because you think you want to keep your layers on, but you got to take the socks off and air them out. You got to put some baby powder on them, some dry powder. Try to take care of your feet. So that's a good observation, Chandler. He did, and he's airing his socks out. You can see. So yeah, all of that. This guy, La La Land for sure.
He's got his mouth.
All right, that was a good little pre-chat on trench warfare. Hopefully, a reminder. Showed you a bunch of pictures. Let's get to now the battles on the Western Front. So Western Front, what was the borders? What two countries?
Germany and France.
Excellent. So the first battle we're going to talk about is the Battle of the Marne, September of 1914. I want you to write down basically everything that comes on the screen. It's your first little block there. I gave you a tick mark already, so you can just write the Marne, September 1914. Basically, the summary of it is that it was a costly Allied victory. The Marne is a river, and if you remember, water is life, and especially from a military perspective, water can be used for transportation. So it's a river in France. The French army started retreating backwards to Paris, and along this long retreat all the way to Paris, there was basically 500,000 casualties. And at the end of the Battle of the Marne, where the French army stopped their retreat, this is where trenches were dug. So this was the first kind of land engagement, much like we talked about, say Bull Run was the first land battle in the Civil War. First land engagement, and where the French army stopped, this is where they dug their trenches, and then those trench lines would stay in place pretty much for the rest of the war. So the Marne, costly Allied victory, 500,000 dead. We can't even fathom those numbers, right? You fill up a stadium in Atlanta, you're talking about 80,000 people. That stadium times 12, 500,000 dead, like that's a lot. Not times 12, times 7 or so. Verdun. Verdun was a long and deadly battle in the year 1916. Now, I know I'm not giving the amount of time to these battles that they deserve, right? It's not a military history class. I can't go over all the moving pieces from a military perspective. That's not really what the class is designed for. Verdun, however, was a 9-month-long battle. At Verdun, we see the first use of tanks and airplanes. So the new technology is getting itself involved in the war. Overall, though, for all the casualties that there were, is very little change in the ground, very little change in the trench line. So just another example of how futile, how many people died and how little progress was made. What's your question?
Okay. So, sure. You know, maybe
I
don't know all the pieces. But
me neither.
Like,
I try.
If it ain't working, why are we still doing it?
You mean in this conflict?
Yeah.
We ain't still doing it today, right? We have changed our trench warfare strategies.
Like, if you took 9 months to do a battle and no land was gained,
yep.
You would think that we would take that in.
I don't disagree, Sanat. There was a lot of live and let live going on. There was a lot of times patrols would flat out ignore each other. A lot of times it was the officers, the generals, and the politicians who were driving the war strategy, whereas the guys on the ground probably would agree with you. Like, hey, we've been at this for 9 months and this isn't working. Why are we going to go over the top again? But tell that to the politician that's in his office in the rear. Tell that to the general who's trying to get promoted and trying to get another award. There's a lot of human nature involved. The people away from the front lines don't understand the struggle of the people on the front lines. Great question. I don't disagree. That gets a little bit more into the military, you know, analysis of what was happening. But I hear you. Good thinking. Next battle we're going to talk about is, this is of Verdun. So, Sanaa, to your point, how long and how arduous it was, a Frenchman, a lieutenant, so that's an officer, but at the lowest rank, okay, not the general, but the lowest rank. I was a lieutenant when I graduated 10 years ago. This French lieutenant, who ultimately would be killed, okay, he died in battle, but this is what he wrote in his journal. Humanity is mad. It must be mad to do what it is doing. What a massacre. What scenes of horror and carnage. I cannot find words to translate my impressions. Hell cannot be so terrible. Men are mad. So, would this guy agree with what you had to say, Sanaa?
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty much. Hell cannot be so terrible as what we're living at Verdun. Guys in the trenches didn't understand what was going on. A lot of them had to be there. They volunteered for service or they were drafted into service. The penalty for desertion was very often death. The generals in the rear, the politicians even farther back than that, were the ones driving the strategy for the most part. Great question. Great thinking. This is a trench that was at Verdun. Like I said, it's a scar in the earth. Now, this photograph was taken in 2009, but I assume it looks still pretty similar. A scar in the earth, right? When we dig into the earth, when we change the face of the earth, we got to consider that it might last for forever. So these trench lines still exist at Verdun to this day. And of course, we memorialize some of them and we turn them into museums, but still, it changed the shape of the earth. It changed the face of the earth. One more battle on the Western Front, and this is called the Somme. The Somme, there were over 1 million casualties between July and November of 1916. It's the worst battle on the Western Front. Most of the casualties happened in no man's land. It was a perfect, classic example of trench warfare. Sanaa, very similar. I know you're going to have the same question. Why did we do it? Most of the death came from artillery and machine guns. So when you think about the tactics that we just talked about, when you think about how machine guns could cut a man down and artillery would blow a man up, the Somme is what should come to mind, because this is the battle where those tactics were most prevalent. And this is another statement from a person, a primary source. Somme, the whole history of the world cannot contain a more ghastly word. So for all the bad words in the world, profanity or descriptions of hell, whatever you want to come up with, this guy says Somme is the worst word on the face of the planet. Yeah, right? A lot of them did. Old Man of the Sea, Ernest Hemingway was a soldier in World War I. A lot of the beatnik poets were soldiers in World War I. So really deep statement there. Maybe some of these guys should become poets. Actually, a lot of them did. So I know that is kind of the first step on your notes there. We have talked about the Western Front. Let's take our break, and when we come back, we will talk about the Eastern Front.
Yeah, Daddy. It just does kind of fast.
Hold on, man. Wait.
He said it.
Yeah, same.
Yeah, come on, let's do it.
Drug and recreational drugs.
Energy. It gives you energy.
Unless you get a chair and roll it.
My daddy and me watched part of the class yesterday.
Oh no, it goes lieutenant. He's gonna be a major and then he's gonna be a lieutenant. Colonel, whatever, colonel, and then brigadier general, and then major general. So he's pretty cool.
Dang, dude, that stuff died. That guy's ugly.
You right? We're gonna be the only one in Austin City. My Adderall is going to be there. And Chris. Oh no, Chris plays baseball. So we're gonna be the only one.
Is it only us? We still not baseball players?
It's gonna be us three.
That is so mean.
I don't
even
know
baseball players.
You mean you're in Austin
City? Oh, do you not want to talk to me? I think that's somewhere else.
No!
Are we going to the stadium here?
Mia can't go. She broke her foot.
It's not broken.
Chase would. No,
it is my
knee. Oh, just kidding. Her knee.
No, I'm sorry.
Her knee.
But it was only not to tell us.
Hey, hold on. I have a public service announcement. Hey, Chandler. Does somebody have anything but candy to eat? I got candy. I think that's a PSA.
I can share.
I might not have a lot. I'm sorry.
All right, hey, we got a fair amount still to get to. Now, up front, I was explaining trench warfare. The notes are going to start flowing. So on the Eastern Front. Eastern Front doesn't get as much press or as much popularity in the grand scheme of World War One. And similarly, I'm not going to talk about it all that much, but I do want us to know a little bit about the Eastern Front. Eastern Front means the border between Germany and Russia. One of the notable battles is this Battle of Tannenberg. It was a major defeat for Russia. I know that is making it really, really simple, but that about sums it up. Russia experienced very high casualties, and because of such, when you experience high casualties in the military, and every single one of those people is a son or a cousin or a nephew or a father, what does your country start to feel about the war?
We should be bad.
Like it's bad that we shouldn't be in it. Yes. So because of the high defeats, the Russian population did not have the resolve to continue the war. There was a disturbance in the force, if you will, and the Russian population started to speak out against their government. Modern application, we're always getting there, right? I think we're pretty close to seeing that in Russia again. I think Russian mothers are about to be tired of their sons dying in Ukraine. Whether they say it's for no reason or not, whatever their national attitude is, I think Russian mothers are about to be tired of their sons dying in Ukraine. So, after World War One now, is exactly what happened. And because of that, there was an uprising of the people. It gets called a revolution, the Revolution of 1917. And really, this forces Russia to leave the war. A little bit more about this. This maybe fits world history a little bit more than U.S. history, but we do have to understand it. It's called the Bolshevik Revolution. And this is the rise of Vladimir Lenin. Vladimir Lenin is the rise of communism. Communism is about to play a big role in America about 2 steps from now, okay? About 2 weeks from now in terms of our class. So this revolution in 1917, Vladimir Lenin rises to the top of leadership. His people group is called the Bolsheviks. And I know that's just a funny word. You're just going to have to remember. This is all related to the Russian Revolution. Yes. They overthrow the standing leader, which is known as a czar, C-Z-A-R, not a president, not a prime minister, but a czar. And as such, they withdraw from the war. I would offer you don't need to write down the name of that treaty. It's fine. They withdraw from the war. This means now how many fronts are there in the war?
One.
All those Germans who've been fighting out east, where can they come?
West.
The West. Ah, so Germany, in a way, Germany, having found a resolution, I don't want to say peace, but having found a resolution with the Russians on the Eastern Front, they can now focus their efforts on the Western Front. Not good for those Frenchies in the trenches trying to fight the Germans. But thank you. So Bolshevik Revolution, the real simple summary is that Russia is out. Okay, bigger piece of world history perhaps, but worth noting in U.S. history because we're going to start having a whole bunch of communism concerns, and it does all stem from the Russian Revolution right here.
We're not in the war yet, are we?
We are not in the war yet. Astute observation. Bolshevik Revolution, bit of a propaganda summary. Mike to drop the mic. Russia is out. So I'm not going to belabor that point. Russia is out. I'm going to pass by that. All right, Zanah, great question. Here we have America ready to join the war. And in terms of your notes, there's a portion that says America enters the war. And then I'm also going to be elaborating on all things related to Woodrow Wilson. So you have your 2 pages in front of you. I trust you're wise enough to see where each of these notes go. America enters the war. In the block that says America enters the war, write these statements, okay? This is kind of the upfront summary, then I'm going to peel it all back. It's in an okay order. Maybe I could have done it slightly better, but hang with me. At this time, most of America is isolationist. What does that mean? The simple word is isolate. Let's hang out by ourselves. Hashtag not our problems, okay? Austrian archdukes being assassinated doesn't concern us. It's an ocean away. It's a whole different continent. America first. Now, there's an alternate attitude about imperialism. We've already walked through that a little bit. But for the most part, I'm not saying everybody, but for the most part, America was isolationist. Assassinations that happened in Austria just plain aren't our problem. Death tolls, right? We're watching the war develop. There's death tolls on two fronts. We are not interested in that. Why would we get involved? It just doesn't involve us. So President Wilson actually campaigns, jot this down, America enters the war, campaigns on keeping America out of the war. His motto for re-election is literally that he kept America out of war. Super ironic is that we are shortly about to enter the war. He gets reelected on that motto, and then we enter the war. But right now, as I'm telling you the story, kind of walking us in order, President Wilson campaigns on the motto of keeping America out of war. Seeing as he is elected and reelected, obviously that's what the American population wanted, to stay out of the war. Picture Woodrow Wilson, right? And then here he is, a little less animated. Wilson, just a bit of a background. He's super academic. Okay? He's super smart, kind of heady. His father was a Presbyterian minister, okay, so a Protestant pastor. And that means that he comes from a background of faith. He did bring his faith into a lot of the decisions he made. And that's kind of notable. You always got to think about who's in charge and what's their personal background. Well, coming from a family of faith, Presbyterian background, that was very influential to his decision-making overall. He was a professor before he was a president, so that's where he comes from, that academic background. And overall, you know, all of that kind of influenced his whole personality, influenced his politics, his campaigning, all that kind of stuff. So could go deeper on Woodrow Wilson. Grand scheme of things, we got to keep our class moving along. I hope you're curious. I hope you'll pay attention to just, you know, all the things around you, whether it's news articles, History Channel, .com, whatever. There's more to be had, and I'm giving you as much as I can. So now we're going to get to the sinking of the Lusitania, and that is the very top of your second page. You can see that we're going to have two key quotes from Wilson coming up, which is why he has a speech bubble on your notes. So manage the space that you have for writing, because I got a couple of data points on each of these, and then we're going to get to those statements that Wilson makes. Lusitania is a merchant ship. Merchant ships are supposed to carry what? Supplies and not people. People, true. But what kind of people? No, they're not supposed to carry military. And then I did hear it over here. Ammunition. Ammunition? Ammunition? All right, that was kind of jumbled, so let me say it. A merchant ship is supposed to carry goods to be traded, not soldiers, sailors, or ammunition. If a ship is genuinely carrying goods to be traded, then it can be called a vessel that is doing trade. But if it's carrying goods to be traded on top and ammunition in the storage holds down at the bottom, it can be considered a military ship. So what happens during this time is that a lot of ships are crossing the Atlantic Ocean flagged as merchant ships. They're saying that all we're doing is trading. But what they were also doing was carrying war supplies, be it ammunition or soldiers or other equipment. So if they got targeted by German submarines, the Germans were saying, we're targeting military ships. The country of origin, whether it was America or Canada or any other, you know, we're going to focus on America right now. America would be like, hey, quit targeting our merchant ships. Germany would say it's a military ship. America would say it's a merchant ship. So what we have here is the recipe for disaster, the recipe for a conflict. Germany, because of this, Germany declares what is known as unrestricted submarine warfare. That means, I'm going to tell you too, then I'm going to show it to you. That means Germany says, they're flat out saying, we are going to torpedo any ship in the ocean. If you cross through these shipping channels and you are not German, we're going to torpedo you. But we're a merchant ship. Don't care, we're going to torpedo you. Because there was enough double crossover of military ships and merchant ships happening, Germany declares unrestricted submarine warfare. Here's the flat-out definition for that. Germany's attitude to conduct submarine attacks on any vessel in the water, warships, commercial ships, or passenger ships. Yes, write this down under unrestricted submarine warfare. Yeah, take that. Unrestricted submarine warfare. Now, I'll give this to Germany. At least they said it. At least they said it out loud. We're going to torpedo any ship in the waters, as opposed to being sneaky about it. But what is this not good for? Who does this really affect?
Literally everybody.
Well, literally everybody, and on what level?
Well, that's our stuff.
Economic level, for sure. What about the legitimate merchant ships? Now we don't have people to trade with. If we can't cross the Atlantic Ocean, raw materials, manufactured goods, I mean, trade is still happening. Germany has restricted this by declaring unrestricted submarine warfare. I shouldn't use that word to make it complicated. Point is, Germany is going to attack. Oh, no name. Germany is going to torpedo any ship in the water, no matter what. America does not like this, for starters, and it's going to lead to the attack on the Lusitania, which I'm about to tell you more about. Trying to set that up front, right? Trying to tell you about what is unrestricted submarine warfare so that you'll understand the attack on the Lusitania in the first place. Couple pictures I got here. It's the best images I could find online. Now, this is not depicting World War I era, but submarine, periscope, there's a ship on the horizon. When it launches its torpedo, the picture on the right, fairly accurate representation of what a torpedoed ship would look like. A little bit more modern than World War I, but still a pretty accurate representation of what a torpedoed ship would look like. So now it brings me back to the Lusitania. This is a graphic, an infographic of the Lusitania. Let me set the scene for you. It's May 7th, 1915. America is not in the war. America is not in the war. Lusitania is a merchant and personnel ship. So, you know, people and goods that would travel between New York and London. New York and London. It is supposed to be a merchant ship. Yeah, it is designed as a merchant ship. It is flagged as a neutral nation. It is a merchant ship, not a military ship. Long story short, trying not to belabor the point, what happens is that a German U-boat spots the Lusitania in its shipping channel, and given that Germany has declared unrestricted submarine warfare, he doesn't care if it's military or commercial or passengers, he's going to shoot it. And that's exactly what happens. This is a representation, not a photograph, but a sketch of the German U-boat, underwater submarine boat, torpedoing the Lusitania. And the Lusitania, go back to this one here, sinks in 18 minutes. It is hit with a torpedo, and shortly thereafter, there is a secondary explosion. What do you think could have caused a secondary explosion? I thought you were going to say fuel. Possible, but a lot of you jumped to, yeah, a lot of people think, and history thinks, that it was carrying ammunition. It's a passenger ship, but given that there was this secondary explosion, it's almost like the torpedo found the ammunition hold and exploded that as a secondary explosion. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, do we know for sure? No, because it was flagged as a passenger ship. But realistically, knowing the attitudes and the behaviors of the day, it was probably carrying passengers and also carrying ammunition. So were the Germans right or wrong? Well, in the end, how about this? They kill over 1,300 people. They killed 1,200 total people. 128 of them are Americans. Ah, now we got to pay attention because the Germans have just attacked a boat and killed Americans. It's actually a British boat, not an American boat, but that is irrelevant to the fact that the Americans were on board. So, now let's continue. The Lusitania is sunk by a German U-boat in 1915. It kills 1,000 total, really about 1,200 based on that graphic, and 130 Americans. And you can see President Wilson's statement here. This is not a direct quote as much as it is a summary of the attitude, and this is what I want you to write down. Wilson says, Germany must apologize, stop targeting peaceful ships, and if they do this, America will stay neutral. Germany apologizes and stops targeting peaceful ships. America will stay neutral. So what he did was threw out a bargain. He said, do you want us in the war? Because we'll join. Or, Germany, back off. Back off on the unrestricted submarine warfare, and we will stay neutral. Not for you, not against you, we'll stay neutral. So write that down. We, you know, and as you can see, we are not, that means we're not yet in the war, right? Wilson has not said we're getting involved in the war. He's giving an option to keep America neutral. Since that was his campaign promise, right? I kept America out of the war. I'm going to keep us out of the war. He's giving an option to keep America neutral. Abby. Put it in the first quotation mark. Yeah, sinking of the Lusitania flows into Wilson's attitude. Probably could have bumped up the submarine warfare block there, but creating as I go. You guys help me out. Thanks. I mean, how boring would it be to just buy a curriculum and just go off of that? Be easier. I don't like to do easy. I like to do good. All right. So what we have right now is a possible agreement to keep us out of the war. We're going to have to see if it can stay that way. Riley had a hand? You good? All right. Show you a couple primary source photographs here in just a second. I want to make sure everybody has a chance to do the writing. Of course, this will be on Google Classroom by the end of the day. I feel like we have good classes. I feel like that we present the information and it doesn't make you responsible for reading it. Other classes might hand you a packet and say, read this. I like to present the information to you to know that I've presented it to you myself personally. It's a little way of explanation for why we do class the way we do. All right, I'm moving on. Here's a newspaper report from that day. Picture of the Lusitania, obviously before it got sunk. Ooh, but boom, remember the Lusitania. So this is going to become a rallying cry. Not immediately, because immediately we are going to decide to stay neutral. But remember the Lusitania is going to become a rallying cry. Remember the Alamo, remember the Maine, remember the Lusitania. If you want to mobilize people for war, you got to have something to remember. Political cartoon for the day. Can you tell who is who based off of the pictures?
Woodrow Wilson and the
German. German with his hat, okay, on the right-hand side, Wilson, because I showed you his photograph and the top hat and all that. Well, political cartoons back in the day were a little bit wordier than they are today. Let's take a look at this. Wilson says, in the name of humanity, I want you to stop your submarine warfare. The German says, in the name of humanity, ooh, okay, they're both coming from the perspective of humanity, I want you to stop the sale of ammunition. So blame is being cast. Blame is being cast. Who's right? Who's wrong? Everybody's mixed up and into the middle. Whether you're selling ammunition or you're targeting civilian ships, everybody's got some wrong going on. Well, briefly, the Germans do suspend unrestricted submarine warfare. Okay? Briefly. They resume it, and that's actually a pretty notable point to draw America into the war eventually. But based off of Wilson's statement, his initial statement, they apologize, they suspend. And for the time being, America can remain neutral. Unfortunately, something else is going to happen, right? There's always something else. That something else is called the Zimmerman Telegraph. Some of you told me about this yesterday when I said, what do you remember from World War I? So I'm glad about that. Let's see how much we remember. What is the Zimmerman Telegraph? Well, it's a secret message from Germany to Mexico. Mexico? I didn't know Mexico was involved in World War I. We haven't mentioned that yet. Well, let's see how it develops. What this telegraph proposes from Germany to Mexico, Germany says, hey, get involved in the war on our side. Attack the United States from the south. Go through Texas and Arizona. If you assault across the southern border, we will support you. When we win, guess what? We're going to give you back Texas, Arizona, Nevada, New Mexico, stuff that you lost in the past. Oh, so now manifest destiny comes into play. Remember when we pieced together our country, that whole region called the Mexican Cession? Germany saying, fight with us. We will invade the United States from the south. And when we win, we'll give you back that land. Kind of playing to that ego of America, or rather the ego of Mexico. Hey, don't you want your land back? If we invade from the south and we win the war together, we'll give you your land back. So this was this telegraph was intercepted thanks to spy craft, okay, thanks to intelligence and the way that they can intercept telegraphs. When it was decoded, I'm going to show it to you in a second. All this telegraph was actually a series of numbers. It actually required a whole bunch of mathematical code cracking to actually understand what it was saying. And I'll be honest, I couldn't do it. It's not my, you know, it's not a gift I have or a skill I have to crack codes. But people who can take a cipher, take the numbers associated with letters and turn that into an actual message, really smart people were able to crack this code. And you know how they did it is they used math. A lot of times you guys are like, what's this math good for? I'm not a math guy. I'm not saying I am. I'm not saying it's something I could study overnight. But people who are well studied in math were able to crack this code. And because of it, quite frankly, prevented maybe an invasion from the South. Who knows?
Right? Bullet point to where it says result.
So I'm going to give you a Wilson quote in just a second. So I'm going to give you the result here in just a second. Good point, Austin. Causes an outrage in America. Here is the Zimmerman telegraph. So like I said, it was just a bunch of numbers. By itself, that is unreadable, right? It's a Western Union telegram. It comes in this form of a whole bunch of numbers. Well, here's how it got deciphered. They're able to take the number and associate it with a word. And again, I'm not telling you that I know how to do that. But in the end, we're able to make it into a message. And here's what it actually says. We make Mexico a proposal of alliance on the following basis. Make war together, make peace together. Generous financial support and an understanding that Mexico is to reconquer lost territory in Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. Fight with us, win with us, we'll give you your land back. So tell me about the great invasion through Texas and Arizona. How did it end up? Never happened, right? It's not a part of our history. Mexico does not get involved in the war. Imagine this, right? I should have pointed out the map earlier. If Mexico invaded from the south, that would be a major part of our history for starters, something we can't even really fathom. We've always prided ourselves on not having any geographic enemies. Canada to the north, not going to fight us. Mexico to the south, not going to fight us. Got oceans on either side. We kind of have the protection of geography. That would have changed everything. If we couldn't trust our neighbor to the south, obviously can make a modern-day connection to Russia invading across the border of Ukraine presently. Here's a very descriptive political cartoon. It shows this hand, and what country does this hand belong to?
Germany.
How can you tell?
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. It is a German symbol and kind of the uniform style of the European countries. Well, he's taking a knife, Mexico, for Mexico, for Mexico. So what's Mexico going to get? Arizona, New Mexico, and Texas. And then California here actually says for Japan, ? I'm not even going to get into that. Point is, this would have reshaped the history of the United States, obviously, to lose territory in that fashion. Well, bullet point kind of already said it. What was the American response to this?
Outrage.
Yeah, it got out. It got out, it made headlines. German makes a proposal to Mexico. As soon as the great American public knew about this, there was no chance to contain the information. And the average person, okay, the average voter, the average citizen, the average military-aged person who might volunteer to go to war said, "Booey on that. We can't stand for that." So what once was isolationism, not our problem, over the ocean, let the Europeans do what they're going to do, now it's a lot closer to being our problem. Leads Wilson to this quote right here. Well, actually, what should the president do at this time? What do you think? If you were the president, what would you do?
Join the war.
Join the war? Would you? Yeah. You campaigned on the idea that you kept America out of the war. Don't care anymore? It's different for someone to actually come over and attack us. So the rules have changed a little bit. Doesn't matter what he campaigned on, things have changed a little bit. So here's what Wilson says, and I do want you to write this quote in the second thought bubble. Here it is. The world must be made safe for democracy. Its peace must be planted on the tested foundations of political liberty. He's basically saying, we're going to go to war for democracy. We are the world's protector in terms of ensuring the spread and safe practice of democracy. We're not going to war because we're offended. We're not going to war because we got attacked. He's justifying it by saying we're going to go to war to spread and protect democracy. Great idea. I like to believe that it is true. I like to believe that his personal attitude was true. But at the same time, I bet there's a little bit of a grudge going on, a little bit of a we want to make them pay kind of thing going on. But from a political perspective, he's saying that what we're going to do is spread democracy. And that kind of gives us a moral perspective to the war. Kind of helps us understand that we're going to go spread democracy, not just kill Germans. Kind of puts us in the right in that regard. So the big end, I know you're writing this quote down, the big end result is that the Zimmermann Telegraph is what drives us to join World War I. A lot of people like to think about the sinking of the Lusitania as a reason that America joined the war. Sinking of Lusitania happened in the year 1915. Very early on in World War I, America did not join the war for nearly 18 more months. Lusitania is a reason. I'll go here now. Lusitania is a reason, but it's not the reason. The reason is the Zimmermann Telegraph. We joined the war, World War I, because of the Zimmermann Telegraph. Riley?
How did America get the telegraph?
Yeah, great question. So it was intercepted across telegraph wire lines. It was sent as a code, right? You know, these are back in this era, we couldn't really, nobody could prevent messages from being intercepted. The goal was to encode them in a way that they couldn't be understood. So it was intercepted, and the Germans probably almost expected that it would be intercepted. But the code, they were hoping their code was strong enough that it couldn't be cracked. It was cracked, therefore we were able to understand what the message was, and the rest is history. Evan? Sure. There's the quote. Sorry, it trickled all the way up to 73 degrees in here. My bad. I feel like people push the buttons that I don't push them. So my big take here is, as some of you are finishing out this quote, it's the Zimmermann Telegraph that drove us to World War I. Not the sinking of Lusitania, not any other side reason. I believe the immediate cause of America going to the war was the Zimmermann Telegraph. So the final result is that the Zimmermann Telegraph got us involved in World War I. What was the final result of the Zimmermann Telegraph? America joins the war. America joins the war. Say it, any phrasing like that. Oh, sorry, that's kind of what I'm sure. My bad. One more thing. Congress officially declares war. So however you wrote it, Congress officially declares war on Germany in April of 1917. Lusitania happens in 1915. And there's just too much time that passes before we actually declare war for that to be considered the cause of the war. Part of it led us to the war, sure, but the Lusitania is not the reason. Now, the Lusitania is the one that gets movies made out of it. Lusitania is the one that's a little bit sexier because there's an explosion and death and dying and boom. But the Lusitania is probably not the reason that led us to war. There's too much time to pass. Zimmermann Telegraph, on the other hand, is. Moving on, put us on fast forward a little bit here. So the nation is now at war. In going to war, a lot of people had to be drafted. There were many willing to volunteer, right? Like, hey, my nation's at war, I want to go. There's also a lot of drafting that happened. Here's a draft card. And if you look at this draft card here, do you notice anything in particular?
I can't
read it. Yeah, don't worry about the words. Just think about the shape of the card. Is there anything? It's a square. Yeah, how about that lower left?
Well, a triangle.
There's a little triangle shape. Now, I'm going to zoom in on it for you because I know you can't read it. It says, if person is of African descent, cut off this corner. Segregation. Volunteering to go to war, but think about it. If this corner gets cut off and it's immediately indicating that that person is of African descent, we're still hanging out in the Jim Crow era. We're still hanging out in a segregated Plessy versus Ferguson type of era. So amidst our country kind of rallying together, there's still that passive, tacit racism and segregation that's going on. I show you that because we're walking ourselves towards the civil rights movement, and we're going to get there. Next picture here. Some of you need this. This is actually called the slacker wagon. So for people who were supposed to go and register for the draft but didn't, and there's always those people who are trying to avoid work, they had literally this truck that would go around town, round people up. It's called the slacker wagon. So some of y'all probably need a slacker wagon to get you to school every day or get you to do your homework, something like that. That's bonus. That's just for funsies. All right. America enters the war. Enters the war in 1917. War's been going on since 1914. America enters the war nearly at the tail end, but if you hear us tell the story, we won the war. We rescued Europe from Germany, from the jaws of defeat. America is the champion, right? That's how we tell our own story. And in reality, the slog had been going on, and so many other European nations had made so many sacrifices that the American, they actually kind of resented America for getting involved in this kind of declaring victory. So it's interesting to think, how do the British tell this story? How do we Americans tell this story? Just keep that in mind. 2.8 million soldiers go overseas. They're drafted into the armed forces. They're called doughboys because they're so clean and fresh. Kind of a derogatory nickname that those Europeans gave to us, as if to say, you haven't been here for the past 3 years. You're so clean and so fresh. You're a doughboy. But we kind of embrace it as a nickname. Fresh American troops turned the tide of the war, helped the Allies. Really, we lead to the end of the war within about 12 months. So gratefully, I mean, I don't know, maybe the world should be grateful that America got involved because we won the war in less than 12 months after we got involved. I'm going to move on. Battles, don't bother writing this down. This is one more battle. There's actually a second Battle of the Marne. It is 2 months long, July to August of 2018. It's an Allied victory. This is a total side fact that I want to give to you because it is this battle where your homegrown Georgia 3rd Infantry Division earned its nickname Rock of the Marne. Second Battle of the Marne, not the first, but the second, the Americans are involved. The 3rd Infantry Division holds its ground and gets nicknamed the Rock of the Marne River or the Rock of the Marne Battle. So to this day, the 3rd Infantry Division is still called the Rock of the Marne. This is the patch of the unit out of Fort Stewart. I know I've told you the history before. It's 1, 2, 3 white stripes. That's how they know that they're the 3rd Infantry Division, by counting the white stripes. That's the unit I was a part of at Fort Stewart. And, of course, I got a personal history with the unit, which is why I like to tell you the story. That was the 100-year anniversary. Yeah. So that's the pitch right now. All right. Total side fact there. Now moving on to Wilson's 14 points. This should be on the Wilson page, I think, right under Wilson's picture. Here's how Wilson wants to end the war. He literally believes he has 14 points to bring about everlasting peace for the rest of time and eternity.
I told you
his dad was a Presbyterian minister. Maybe they wrote 14 point sermons, right? Good Baptist sermon has about 3 points. Maybe the Presbyterians had a 14 point sermon. Now that's a little bit of hope. So here's the 14-point plan. Here's what I want you to write down. Wilson's plan for long and lasting peace, but, and there's always a but, it conflicts with the European desire to punish Germany.
There's only 5.
You did really good.
Write it right under the word Woodrow Wilson. I'm actually going to get you to the whole statement. The whole statement. Woodrow Wilson's plan for long.
Yes.
Recap. I'm not going to have you write down all 14. I want you to write down this should probably have gone right here at this first bullet point. See how that box is kind of
what,
like its own rectangle?
So just write it as the first bullet point.
Yes, write it as the first bullet point.
Which one?
My bad. You can't do it wrong. I promise you, I'm not going to say, wow, they missed that bullet point.
Well, it's wrong in the first box because you need me to put it in the first box.
Yeah. Woodrow Wilson's plan for long-lasting peace, but it conflicts with Europeans' desire to punish Germany. You got to think that the Americans got to the game late. The Americans did not suffer nearly as much bloodshed, death, dying, destruction.
So does that number 2 go on the second one?
I'm sorry. I know my numbers messed you up.
Okay.
I apologize for the numbers.
That's only one.
I took the numbers off.
Oh,
It doesn't matter where you write it down. Put it under Woodrow Wilson's name. It's like the area.
Yeah, it will stress me out.
Yeah, I can tell.
Just
I can
where?
Tell. Did Josh, you stressed out by this? No, not. My bad on the format. We're good. We can move on. Here's a picture.
It
must
too.
So bad.
Sometimes I assume you're college kids, and I know you're not. All right. Thank you for your help. I'm sure I'll make it better for next year. This picture here shows a couple of European powers, and they are saying we got to punish Germany for this war. But Wilson, on the other hand, he wants to focus on peace. But you got to think about it. If you've been fighting the war against the Germans, you're probably ticked off at how they've been treating your country. You want to punish them. Wilson didn't share that same perspective. Wilson wanted to, he wanted his legacy to be one as a peacemaker, a peace builder. I told you, coming from his Christian perspective, his father was a minister. I think, personally, I think that that was influential to his overall diplomacy and his attitude. Here is all of Wilson's 14 points. I'll give you a second to get that written down. That's a joke. Obviously, that's a joke. Let me summarize it for you. I'm going to even summarize it faster than that. Here is where I intended you to write five items.
You literally said the last one to write.
It's okay. You're going to fit it in there. I believe in you. You're going to have to give me extra time.
Now it looks trash.
Exactly.
It's not about how it looks.
I like hanging out with these guys a lot. Here are five key points that come out of the 14. Okay, 14 points was probably a little too lengthy. Right? Ain't none of you want to listen to a 14-point sermon. I think 14 points was a little too wordy for the world community to really digest. Here are the summary of the 14. One, all nations have the right to conduct foreign policy. So that kind of busts up the idea of alliances. Two, this gets directly to the unrestricted submarine warfare and the sinking of the Lusitania. All countries have the right to the freedom of the seas, to trade goods, to move their military. All countries have the right to move boats on the seas. The next, I don't even want to say one, two, and three. I'm just going to say the next is saying the freedom to trade. It doesn't matter if you're with an alliance or not. You have the right to trade to anybody altogether. The next one in quotation marks, and I'm going to explain it because of such, self-determination means that colonies have the right to decide whether they want to be their own nation or whether they want to belong to an empire. This is the beginning of breaking up the Austria-Hungarian Empire, the German Empire, even the British Empire. Take a real close to our heart example like Canada. Canada has the right to determine whether it wants to be a colony of the British Empire or it wants to be its own country. So self-determination probably tugged at the heartstrings of some of these smaller countries who wanted to express their own independence instead of being a part of an empire. And the last one you see on the screen, probably most significant, a creation of the League of Nations. Tell me about the League of Nations today.
Well,
It doesn't exist is right. So plot twist, it never really got its foundation. I'm going to tell you about it briefly here in a second. So summary of the 14 points, not just 14 of them in a row, but this is the summary of the 14 points. From this, right, so there's actually a big campaign to try to get Germany to agree to these 14 points. This is very lenient to Germany. It's actually a very gracious surrender terms to Germany. However, so Germany agreed to this. Hey, there's some side chatting. I know that I messed up the notes. It's whatever. Let me finish. We got to get to lunch, right? Just let me finish or else we're going to bleed into a third day here. Germany was willing to agree to these surrender terms. This is, in the end, not exactly what happened. Germany ends up getting treated much more harshly. So from this, Germany agrees to an armistice. An armistice is a laying down of the arms, not a full-on peace plan, but a laying down of the arms. And from that, we have the last firing of the guns on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. That is November 11th. And from November 11th, we in America have Veterans Day, okay? I showed you this video last year. You can literally hear the guns go silent, shooting up till the very last minute of the war, and then the guns go silent. So this is the armistice, but it leads to the Treaty of Versailles. The Treaty of Versailles, it's your last thing on the notes, I believe, is different than the 14 points. Wilson's 14 points were generous. Wilson's 14 points did not at all resemble the Treaty of Versailles. The Treaty of Versailles was much harsher to Germany. Now, what's tricky about it is that Germany was not invited to the negotiations. You might understand that because they've been so harsh to all these other European countries. Why in the world would we want to sit at a table with Germany? But in the end, it really bred a lot of resentment in the German people. They thought that they were getting a raw deal. Here's what the Treaty of Versailles says. Germany must, this is what I want you to write, V-R-A-N-T. Germany accepts blame for the war. Germany is forced to pay reparations. That means financial. Germany has a limited army. So for their defense, they can have 100,000 troops. But they cannot have more than that. If you have more than 100,000 troops, the fear was that they would invade again. And then finally, the T is that Germany loses territory that it had even before World War I. Nobody wants to give up territory, so that was definitely a big punishment overall. This is much harsher than Wilson's 14 points. And the German population did not appreciate this. They did not appreciate that their leaders signed this treaty. They thought that they should have pushed back against them. The German people, the German population did not appreciate this treaty. They thought that their leaders actually called them criminals. They said, because you agreed to this treaty, you are a criminal. So there's a lot of issues inside of Germany at this point. A lot of people say that the Treaty of Versailles was such a weak treaty that it leads to World War II. Some people say that if the Treaty of Versailles negotiated better, had been, you know, had included Germany in the negotiations and such, maybe, just maybe, now we can't go back in history and really find out, but maybe, just maybe, the World War II wouldn't have been created in the same way that it was. So this is the Treaty of Versailles. The real important take out of that, however, is Wilson's focus on the League of Nations.
Take a picture of it. That's
when I'll... Hey, let me finish, because there's an important point here, and if you'll hear me on that, I never say this out loud, I'm going to elaborate on a test question. So in the next few seconds, I'm literally going to give you a test question answer. Now I've got your attention. Wilson's proposal for the League of Nations was seized upon by some countries. Some countries seized upon, what a great word. Several countries joined League of Nations. You know who didn't? The United States. Wilson's own country. 5 minute bell. Wilson's own country does not join the United States. He advocates for League of Nations. He advocates for us joining the League of Nations for the rest of his life. He actually works himself to death. Many people think that he died of tiredness in the next several years because he worked so hard trying to get the Senate to agree to join the League of Nations. We don't join the League of Nations just because the president says so. The Senate has to ratify the treaty that says we will join the League of Nations. I'm going to show this to you now, right? League of Nations does get organized Several countries join, but you can see the United States never does. The United States is gray. It never joins. So Wilson's own proposal does not actually happen inside of his own country. League of Nations exists until 1946. It goes away. It was a weak organization. It never really had enough power. Today, what do we have? The United Nations is what you meant to say. Today, we have the United Nations, which is a stronger organization. It keeps the world united and in agreement and in negotiations, at least. And then a little bit more specifically, there is NATO, which is certainly in the news today. That's more of a defensive treaty. United Nations is all countries coming together to have negotiations. It's better than fighting each other. NATO is specifically a defensive treaty. Here's something kind of, this will be the last one. I'll finish it here. This is this shows that Uncle Sam is basically handcuffed by the League of Nations. England joins, Japan joins, Europe, four other foreign nations join, but Uncle Sam himself is handcuffed by being tugged in so many different directions, which means that Wilson can never get the Senate on board. Wilson can never get the Senate to agree to join the League of Nations. So there you have it. That was a lot of presentation. Leave it right there. That was a lot of presentations. Got a little jumbled when we kind of got off track on the notes, but I feel like you guys got the heart of it. We'll be drilling you on some of the vocab in the coming days, and we still got a little bit more to talk about. We're going to talk about America on the home front. So, all that said, go ahead and get tidied up. If you got any questions or something I messed up, I can help you with it.
What?
Do you have any questions on something I messed up?
Oh,